So the LHE are certainly the last piece in establishing the standard model as a successful description of nature. And I think it's fair to say that the standard model itself is really a triumph of quantum mechanics and special relativity. Under this framework, the particles are representation of the Poincaré group, which means that they are labeled by two quantities, two numbers, the spin and the mass. So the spin is supposed to be a quantized quantity, 0, 1 half, 1, etc. And the mass is supposed to be a continuous parameter. And this seems to be in pretty good agreement with the experimental data. If you look at the mass spectrum, let's say, of the quarks and the lepton, it seems that they are taking more or less random and continuous value. Nonetheless, this is actually incompatible with the gauge symmetry, with the quantum numbers of all these particles under the gauge symmetry of the standard model, because the standard model is a chiral theory, so the left-handed and the right-handed fermion don't transform in the same way, and this implies that the mass of the fermion has to vanish. It's also true for the mass of the gauge boson. If gauge symmetry is an exact symmetry, then the mass has to vanish. So this was the main problem, the mass conundrum, until basically 2 years ago. And we know the solution. The solution is spontaneous symmetry breaking. And the main thing is really that the masses are not fundamental UV quantity, but they are just emergent quantity due to the non-trivial structure of the vacuum. And the first consequence is actually that we have to correct all the dictionary that were defining vacuum as a space entirely devoid of matter. Now we know that vacuum is actually a space filled with the Higgs substance. So if you think about it, actually, this solution of the spontaneous symmetry breaking mechanism is something which is not totally trivial, right? That the vacuum is actually breaking some symmetry. So for instance, as it was reminded by Jolikan in a conference earlier this year, if you take the double well potential, the ground state is actually a superposition of two states that are localized in each of the minimum, in such a way that the ground state is actually preserving the Z2 symmetry between the axis here. So this example, there is no spontaneous symmetry breaking, while we know that in nature, the vacuum, as we know it, actually breaks the symmetry of SU2 cross U1 down to U1 of electromagnetism. So that was a big achievement. Really, we have discovered that the vacuum has a non-trivial structure. So what is the landscape after this major milestone? And I think this was nicely summarized at the same conference by Michelangelo Mangano. He said that the days of guaranteed discovery are gone. We are not sure that we are going to discover anything else. At the same time, we are left with a big question in particle physics, the hierarchy problem, the flavor masses, the neutrino, dark matter, matter asymmetry, etc. We still don't know exactly how those problems are solved. And also, you shouldn't expect any progress from the theory side, and we really need some experimental input to actually understand what is going to happen next, right? And certainly, in this quest, the Higgs discovery set a large part of the agenda for both the theoretical and experimental high-energy program over the next couple of decades. So there are certainly plenty of open questions in the Higgs sector. Well, the first one, is Higgs actually correspond to the standard model Higgs? Is it an elementary or composite particle? Is it unique or solitary, or whether it comes with other partners or friends? Is it eternal or temporary? Is it natural? What actually prevents the radiative correction to drive its mass up to the Gut scale or the Planck scale? Is it the first supersymmetric particle ever observed? Is it really responsible for the masses of all the elementary particles? Is it mainly produced by top quark or by a new heavy vector-like particle? Is it a portal to a hidden, a dark world? Is it at the origin of matter-antimatter asymmetry? Has it driven the inflationary expansion of the early universe, et cetera, et cetera? Certainly, I don't have any answer to all these questions. And there are still some open questions. Can you ensure that Brazil will win the World Cup? And as a physicist working in Barcelona, I also need to know whether it can help Catalonia to become a sand member state after the independence referendum. So let me try to provide some clues about some of these questions. So is Higgs solitary? So as we say, you know, there is no particular reason to expect that there is a single Higgs boson, and actually there are many models, many well-motivated models, like for instance hypersymmetry, where indeed there is more than one boson. And actually you can use the measurement of the 125 GeV Higgs coupling to already constrain the existence, for instance, of a second Higgs. And this what was done, for instance, in this Atlas publication, where they exclude some region of the parameter space on the two Higgs doublet model, you know, that will predict too large deviation for the coupling of the Higgs that has been observed. The real question is, of course, how to search exactly for the second Higgs. Should we reuse a standard model search in the high mass region? But then what about, you know, new production mechanism, new decay modes due to new particle running into the loop, et cetera, et cetera. So certainly there are new ideas needed to really cover and search in a model-independent way, for instance, for a second X. Right? Then there is a question whether the X is eternal. You know, this morning we have heard about eternal inflation. So there is one question whether the X is eternal or whether it's only a temporary particle. Right? So this has to do, of course, with the fate of the electric vacuum. So in principle, you know, you can take the measurement of all the input parameter of the standard model, namely the gauge coupling, the Yukawa coupling, the Higgs self-interaction, etc. You can take the measurement as at the weak scale and run up to higher energy, and you will get this kind of plot up to you can extrapolate up to the Planck scale, basically. And it seems that everything is more or less fine. You know, there is no big problem. Everything remains weakly coupled, so you can really trust your computation. The only open question is about, you know, the behavior of the Higgs self-interaction. Here it seems that it can actually become negative, and if lambda becomes negative, then there is a problem that the potential will have a runaway behavior at very large value of the field. In other words, the electric vacuum here at 246 GeV is actually not the true vacuum of this Higgs potential, but it's only unstable or metastable, and it can decay actually to the true vacuum. So in this case, the Higgs, as we know it, actually, and our electric vacuum will be only temporary and will decay eventually, maybe in a long lifetime, but it will decay into the true vacuum. So it's a very important question to know, you know, exactly where we are sitting in this phase diagram of the standard model. And there are two main parameters that are really controlling this phase diagram, which is the mass of the Higgs boson and the mass of the top quark, which of course control the radiative correction due to the top loop quark. Right? And it seems, you know, that we are living in a very particular region of this phase space, a near critical region between a stability and instability region. So certainly, in order to understand and answer this question better, we need a more precise measurement of the mass of the Higgs boson itself, but also, and more importantly, I think, a better measurement of the top quark mass. So is Higgs a portal to hidden or dark world? You know, for a very long time, we all believe that there is, you know, new physics, which is charged under the standard model gauge group, simply to address the hierarchy problem. And then it was very reasonable to assume that among these new particles, one of them will be a dark matter candidate, it's stable, etc. Now that so far we haven't found any clues of new physics around the TV scale, maybe, you know, this WIMP hypothesis has to be revised a little bit. And you can think of other model of dark matter where the dark matter will be actually neutral, totally neutral under the standard model interaction. And then it will communicate with us only via the Higgs boson, and this is called the Higgs portal. And for instance, there is this kind of interaction which, you know, you can write perfectly in your Lagrangian. This is a fully renormalizable interaction, etc. It's just a coupling between the Higgs boson and a new scalar dark matter particle. So how do we search for this? Well, you can obviously search for this new scalar through direct dark matter experiment, you know, and this will be a probe, for instance, of the interaction between the dark matter and the Higgs particle. You can also search for this new particle at the LHE, you know, for instance, via monophoton or monojet experiment, or also, as we have heard in the previous talk, in the production by VBF or associated production in this kind of channel here. And finally, there is also some indirect search because, you know, if it's light enough in such a way that the X can decay into a pair of this scalar field, then it will affect, you know, it will appear as an invisible branching ratio that will affect all the cross-section time branching ratio of the standard model. So you, in the global fit of the X coupling, then you will see an evidence of this branching ratio, invisible branching ratio, and from that you can basically put some constraint on this coupling between the X and the dark matter particle. And some friends at CERN have done this nice analysis comparing the different methods, and it seems actually that, you know, the indirect measurement of the invisible branching ratio is actually very powerful and gives us the strongest constraint if, of course, the mass of the dark matter is light enough. And actually, the direct search at the LHE are not never really competitive with this invisible measurement, and neither, not competitive either with the dark matter direct searches. So, has X anything to do with the matter-antimatter asymmetry? And this question, of course, has to do with the dynamics of the electric phase transition. So we know that such an asymmetry between matter and antimatter can be produced during an out-of-equilibrium phase in the early cosmological history of the universe. And of course, you could think of using the electric phase transition itself, but it has to be first order. And what determines the dynamics of the phase transition is actually the finite temperature correction to the X potential, something that we don't have access to directly at the LHE because the LHE is not a Big Bang machine, you know, always working at zero temperature. But you can reconstruct actually the finite temperature X potential via simple rules of quantum mechanics if you know well enough all the couplings at zero temperature. So basically, you can really test, you know, the dynamics of the phase transition by measuring with high accuracy this X coupling at zero temperature. Of course, we all know that in the standard model, the first order phase transition is not possible because the mass of the X is too heavy. But in physics beyond the standard model, it's still possible to have actually a first order phase transition still compatible with other measurements so far. So for instance, you can have some new physics model that will actually modify the X potential at tree level. And the consequences of this kind of scenario is that if you want to have a first order phase transition, then you will see some deviation of the order of 100% in the measurement of the X self interaction, something that will be certainly visible at the high luminosity phase of the LHE, or certainly also at the linear collider or TLEP. You could also think about more complicated model where actually the correction to the X potential, the dynamics of the electric phase transition doesn't occur at tree level, but is only generated via a particle running into the loop. And again, you can think about some type of a portal model with a new scalar field that is coupled to the X via this kind of interaction, this quartic mixing. And then depending a little bit what are the quantum number of this new particle, you know, you can have some deviation in gluon fusion, or in X to gamma gamma, or even in the extralum cross section. And again, if you want to have a first order phase transition, you get those estimates in the deviation in those different channels, and all these things will actually be visible basically in a X factory, I mean, either the high luminosity LHE or the linear collider, or maybe here only the TLEP machine, actually. So, is the particle observed the standard model Higgs boson. So what is actually the standard model Higgs boson? Well, the main property is actually to give the masses to the W, the Z, and the quark and the lepton. And to do that, you know, in order to avoid any problem at very high energy, you know, you need some very precise coupling of the X particle to the W and the Z and to the fermion. Basically, in order to avoid, you know, the WW scattering cross-section to grow with the energy, then you need to tune this linear coupling of the X to the W and the Z. In the same way, if you want to avoid any perturbative unitarity problem in WW producing 2X, then you need to tune the quartic coupling to be basically the squared of the linear coupling. And the same thing is also true in the coupling to the fermion. And that's really the main property of the Higgs boson, to unitarize all the scattering amplitude at very high energy. And it turns that all the couplings are actually proportional to the masses of the particle. And this is a famous plot that was shown also by André before. And indeed, all the current measurement seems to agree pretty well with this standard model-like picture. Another very important property of the standard model is that it has a very particular structure among the flavor space, you know, because the Higgs and the Yukawa interaction are the only sources of the fermion masses. So they are all coming from the Yukawa interaction, and when you expand the Higgs around its vacuum expectation value, you certainly get masses, the mass matrix, and you also get the mass you also get a matrix that, you know, measures the interaction between the Higgs and the fermion. And clearly, since here you have a single matrix to start with, both of those matrices are the same, and they can certainly be diagonalized simultaneously. And this ensures the absence of three-level flavor-changing neutral that could be induced by the Higgs boson itself. But of course, this property is not true anymore, for instance, if the standard model fermion mix with vector-like partners, or if there is non-standard model-like Yukawa, for instance, this higher-dimensional operator that also contribute to the mass, and then they will come with a different factor when it comes for the interaction between the Higgs and the fermion. So this certainly prompts to the search for a flavor-violating decays, for instance, Higgs to mu tau or Higgs to E tau. Also, maybe the top can decay into a Higgs and a charm quark. So the indirect constraints are rather weak, I mean about 10%, and now ATLAS and CMS are actually a sensitivity of the order 1% for the branching ratio, for this rare branching ratio. And certainly a linear collider or a TLEP machine can do much better in this regard. There is also some other rare decays of the Higgs that can be interesting to search for. For instance, when the Higgs decays into a pseudoscalar or vector meson, you know, with branching ratio actually that are not so incredibly small, and you know, with high luminosity, maybe you can search for these things that will certainly be sensitive to new physics. Then there is another very important question, you know, which is about the production of the Higgs. Is the Higgs produced by top quark? So the main production mechanism is, of course, by vector boson, by gluon fusion, which is a loop of top quark. But at the end of the day, you know, because of the low energy effective theorem, you are not sensitive so much about the details of the loop, in such a way that whether the top mass, the top quark has a mass of 170 GeV or whether it has an infinite mass doesn't give you very big difference in the cross-section, of the inclusive cross-section. It's only about 1%. So certainly we cannot understand yet at the moment whether there is actually long distance physics, like modified top coupling, or short distance physics, like new particle running through the loop, that compete to actually reproduce the cross-section as it is measured now. And as a matter of fact, you know, you could really couple, mix the top quark with some vector-like partner. This is the case, for instance, in composite X model. And then there is two effects. There is new particle running to the loop, and they also modify the top Yukawa coupling. And the two effects cancel. And at the end of the day, you can see that the cross-section here is basically insensitive, I mean, up to few percent, is insensitive to this top partner. So maybe there is new physics. This new physics is actually producing the Higgs boson, but we don't see it because of the peculiarity of this top loop. So we certainly need to find a way to break this degeneracy between short distance physics and long distance physics. The way to go is certainly to look at TTH production, but this is a very complicated channel because, you know, complicated finite state, small cross section, etc. And even at very high luminosity, you know, the sensitivity will be only about 10% in the measurement of the top Yukawa coupling. Another way to measure the top Yukawa coupling is actually to look at the TT bar cross section close to the threshold, where you will be sensitive also to the top Yukawa coupling. So this is something that can be done at an E plus E minus machine. So what is the future for X physics? Well, it's certainly a new channel with more than one X boson, with boosted X boson or off-shell X measurement. So it is interesting actually to look at, you know, the cross-section of the various processes. So basically the single Higgs processes, which is dominated by gluon fusion, has a cross-section of about 50 picobarn. And then you can add, you know, new jets, for instance, or add more Higgs, etc. And then the cross-section is certainly going down significantly. So The single X processes were certainly the physics of the LHE in 2012. Now we have to wait for the next run, you know, to see extra jets, or certainly a few more years, maybe 2025, to see two X bosons associated also with some extra jet. And about the triple X boson, maybe we have to wait for the far future. This future circular collider maybe can have access to this one. The future circular collider could also be a factory to produce the X in association with extra particles. So for instance, here, X associated di boson, so with two, either 2W or 2Z, you have a cross-section that increased by about three orders of magnitude between the LHE at 14 TeV and the FCC at 100 TeV. So certainly, we can do a lot of physics with X now as a triggered particle, basically. So why are we so interested in going beyond single X processes? Well, because so far, the LHE has mostly actually produced the Xs on shell in processes with a characteristic scale which is close to the mass of the X boson itself. And from that, you have seen the usual plot that really extract all the couplings at all the X coupling at a scale around the mass of the X itself. Now, producing an X with boosted additional particle will be a probe really to probe the X coupling at larger energy, which is very important, of course, if you want to understand whether the X is really responsible to ensuring perturbative unitarity. You need to know exactly where the coupling are at very high energy. Also, you could think about, you know, the difference between on-shell and off-shell, like, for instance, what happened for the Z. So at LEP1, you were measuring the Z on-shell, and this, you could really probe some deviation in the correction of the standard model. So you basically you could put some bound on S and T oblique correction. And when you were going off-shell, then you were probing actually new direction in this correction. Basically, you were able to, you know, to put some bound on two other additional oblique corrections that are Y and W, which in principle occur at the same order as S and T, but couldn't be probed at LEP1 because of the off-shell production. Actually, for the X data, the things are a little bit more complicated. You are not going really to probe new directions that are not probed already by on-shell data, but you can extract some other type of information, as I want to argue in a moment. So one way to produce an off-shell X is certainly via associated production. And there have been some analyses that have been reported, you know, where you can use basically the high invariant mass in the of the system of the X with the vector boson, where you can see really some important difference between the standard model and new physics, and also in the XPT. So now if you try to extract actually model independent of information out of those measurements, actually it's not that easy because, you know, you are probing basically a very large energy range where basically you are reaching the limit of your effective field theory analysis. So it's not that clear that actually you can put some robust model independent bound using this kind of information. You can certainly extract some information, you know, if there is very light new physics modifying this propagator here. But there is also other way to probe this light new physics. So going back again to high energy, so for instance, you could use double X production in vector boson fusion, and again test, you know, whether the X is really restoring perturbative unitarity. So this means, you know, in the high invariant mass of the 2X system, whether there is an increase or not. For that, you are probing basically this nonlinear interaction of the X with two gauge boson versus the squared of the linear interaction. And there is some analysis, some Monte Carlo analysis that have been done by a group at CERN, and this is basically the kind of information that you can extract. So limited information on the X-self coupling, because this is, you know, a coupling which is really controlling physics at threshold, but you can get some very useful information on the nonlinear interaction, basically, between 2X and two gauge boson. The same is also true for gluon fusion double X production. So here again, you are sensitive to many new couplings. And of course, now if you assume really that the X is part of an electric doublet, then some of those new nonlinear interactions are actually related to the linear interaction between, for instance, this interaction, you know, between two top quark and two X boson that doesn't exist in the standard model is certainly actually related to the correction to the Yukawa coupling between a single X and two quark boson. And the same is also true here. For this vertex between two gluon and two X boson, this is related actually to the interaction between two gluon and one Higgs boson. And then, you know, if you have access to this measurement, to this new coupling, you can test whether or not those correlations are true. So this is a way to test whether the Higgs is part of a doublet or not. And again, there is some Monte Carlo analysis, you know, that shows the prospect of this measurement at very high luminosity, LHE, and also at the 100 TV machine, where you can really get some, finally, some very good sensitivity. Then, finally, two new channels that I would like to describe, which is a boosted Higgs. So producing the Higgs in gluon fusion in association with a very boosted Higgs. And this is a way, actually, to resolve the structure of the top loop. You know, as I was saying, you know, the inclusive cross-section is actually insensitive to the details of the loop, but this is no longer true, of course, if you give a kick to the X by producing an additional boosted X. And here you can see, for instance, that there is about 30% sensitivity on the mass of the top quark if you go to a PT of the X about 300 GeV. Of course, the price to pay for that is that the cross-section requiring a large PT is reduced significantly, about three order of magnitude again, between, you know, the inclusive cross-section to the PT bigger than 600 GeV. And now you can see that indeed you are understanding exactly what is going on into the loop. For instance, you can see the top partners and see the difference between the inclusive cross-section. And finally, there is this off-shell measurement that have been reported. So naively, you do not expect any important effect due to the off-shellness of the X, simply because the ratio of the width divided by the mass is so small. But actually, there is some particular coupling structure that ensure that actually you can have some enhancement of off-shell X. And at the end of the day, if you look at the gluon fusion production of the off-shell X that decays into a pair of Zs, even if the invariant mass of the two Zs are above 300 GeV, then you still get something like 50% of the cross-section. So there is still a lot of X that is produced off-shell. And this is, in a sense, due to the particular structure of the coupling of the X to the longitudinal component of the Z. And actually, there is a strong interference, negative interference, between those two kinds of diagrams. You know, the one which is mediated by the X by itself is growing like the log squared of the energy. And then there is a box, the standard model contribution itself, and the two cancel with each other to ensure unitarity again, in such a way that if the X coupling are exactly the one predicted by the standard model, actually, at the end of the day, the amplitude is not growing with the energy. But this means that if you modify it a little bit, you know, the X coupling, then you are no longer sensitive to this constellation, and then you have a huge increase of the cross-section or the amplitude. So this means that this off-shell production mode is really a way to test the structure of the coupling at high energy. So it was interpreted, as it was reported in the previous talk, as a bound on the X width. But you know, there are some assumptions into this analysis. And the main assumption is really that the coupling of the X on shell at the mass of the X are the same as the coupling of the X at very high energy, which is a little bit questionable, in particular regarding the unitarity property of the models. So what you can do instead is really trying to put some bounds on the modified coupling of the X, in particular in order to disentangle, you know, the coupling of the X to the top quark and the contact interaction of the X to the gluon by shrinking the top loop. And indeed, the two of them have some different high energy behavior. So now you can really use this off-shell measurement actually to put some bound and extract the measurement of the top Yukawa coupling itself without basically relying on TT bar H channel. So the sensitivity is not particularly good. You get something like 20 or 30% sensitivity with free inverse autobahn, which is maybe a little bit worse actually than TTH at the end of the day, but it will be complementarity. So the conclusion, where is everybody? What is the scale of new physics? We still don't know. We have certainly some bound coming from some measurement, but we still hope actually that there is some new physics around the TV scale, mainly driven by the hierarchy problem, and this makes the X a very particular character. And certainly the precision X physics is on the high energy physics agenda for the next two or three decades, for a deeper understanding of the standard model, for an accurate comparison with experiment, and also for an access to the standard model, to physics beyond the standard model. So who is going to win? So it's very difficult to predict, of course, but for physics, it's more clear. Maybe at the end of the day, is the standard model who is winning. Whatever the standard model is, it will be incorporated in the standard model itself. So thanks a lot.
Thank you very much, Christophe. So, since we are running late, only two questions, let's say. Okay, there, in the middle.
Can you please go back to your slide number 11?
Take a bit of time. Yes.
Yes, okay. So the phase diagram, the stability phase diagram on the top. So you quote this diagram, and I would like to say that there is a recent paper, Physical Regulator, December 2013, where it has been shown that actually this diagram is not universal. Although you assume that the standard model is valid all the way up to the Planck scale, still it is shown that Planckian dynamics can affect strongly the phase diagram. So this is just one out of several different possibilities. And I think saying that measuring the top mass with precision, saying that we live at the edge of the stability line, is a bit of an overstatement, because new Planckian dynamics, even if it lives at the Planck scale, can totally modify this diagram. This is the content of this paper.
I agree that, I mean, we don't have good control on the threshold correction, in particular on the threshold correction at very high energy. So, yeah, there is a huge assumption going on to this.
It's more than that. Okay, we can discuss this.
So you mentioned that standard model Higgs couplings can be modified by heavy particles running into the loops.
Yes.
So assuming that LHC running at full energy, let's say in the next 2-3 years, will increase directly limits on these heavy particles by another factor of 2-3, how it will affect what the accuracy on couplings will be needed? So will they just become well below 1% and very
So you
difficult?
Mean the top partners running into the loop?
Yeah.
So the current bond are around 700 GeV, and you know the projection are reaching about the sensitivity about 1 TeV. So, I mean, again, in inclusive cross-section, you know, the effect totally disappear, and they will have an effect only on TTH channel, or if you want, on this kind of channel that I was proposing, the boosted X or off-shell measurement. But for inclusive quantities, they have no effect, right? Because there is an exact constellation due to the particular structure of the mass matrices. So, in a sense,
Very short one. You have seen the experiments are already producing preliminary results on the differential cross-section of the Higgs, the PT distributions, angular distributions.
Yes.
But I saw in your talk leading order only calculations, so we would need really an effort there, otherwise...
Yes, I mean, it's really a frontier. If you want to look at the boosted X, I mean, there have been some N squared ALO computation, but done only in the infinite top mass limit. So there is no next to leading order computation keeping the mass of the top finite, in a sense. And this is certainly has to be done for this boosted analysis, yes, I agree.
Okay, thank you very much again, Christophe.